Raina, Varalakshmi, shall we start?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Raina, mute your mic, Raina. Good morning, students. Am I audible?
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, ma'am.
So this semester I'm going to handle embedded systems and IoT laboratory. And supporting faculty members are Rohanaidhi madam, Diana madam, and Dhanalakshmi ma'am. Okay. So this map focuses on ARM Cortex M4 processor-based assembly and embedded C programming and application-oriented IoT programming. Okay. So this time we have introduced IoT concepts, that is IoT experiments, in this syllabus, and also we have introduced new board, that is STM32F446 development board. So this is the new board we have introduced. STM32F446 Nucleo 64 development board. So this board is based on ARM Cortex M4 core. So manufacturer for this development board is ST Microelectronics. Okay. So most of the experiments are based on this STM32 boards. Okay, and we are going to use KMDK ARM version 5 software. So this is one of the IDEs. So this IDE is mainly developed for programming ARM Cortex M4 processor. Okay. So this is your list of experiment. Okay. So first three experiments concentrate on assembly language programming, so which will help you to understand architecture, data core model of ARM Cortex M4, and instruction set of ARM Cortex M4 processor. And 4, 5, 6 focus on embedded C programming, so which will cover your GPIO port programming, LED interfacing, both internal and external toggling, external LED toggling, timer and counter programming, and how to handle interrupt, and some of the serial port programming. Okay, and 2 IoT, that is Node MCU or Arduino based experiments, have been included to cover IoT concepts. Also, 1 case study experiment have been included. Okay, so it's like a integrated system. You can use either ARM Cortex M4 simulators or Arduino or Node MCU ESP8266 based simulators. Okay, so you need to develop complete system. So for that we have identified a few projects. Okay, so you have to design an integrated data acquisition system based on the concepts what you have studied in the second cycle experiment. Okay, so the projects are completely based on second cycle experiments. Okay, so this is about your weekly schedule. So first cycle we have 5 experiments. Okay, so first 4 experiments don't require hardware, that is don't require hardware environment. We will be able to do it using KMDK ARM version 5. Okay, so we have planned to give online video demonstration with step by step execution, so that you would be able to understand how data can be transferred between your internal registers and between internal registers and memory, and both internal and how to access internal and external memory. Okay, and 5, 6, 7, 8 experiment. So 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay, require a Nucleo board, that is hardware. So we have planned to take video demo for this experiment, and the important feature of this board is it is embed enabled. Embed enabled means using online simulator we can access the board features. Okay, so this board, this particularly this STM32 board, supports online compiler. So So we will ask you to complete these experiments using online compiler, okay? And generally in each experiment there will be a 2 to 3 subdivision, okay? So one of the subdivision will be explained by our faculty member, and we will ask you to submit, that is ask you to simulate and submit the remaining, okay? And the next week, the coming week, you will be asked to present the simulated output. So for that we have formed a team, okay? So batch members have to explain the program logic results which you have got from the experiment, okay? So in week 6 we have planned to conduct continuous assessment 1, and week 11 we have planned to conduct continuous assessment 2, and we have included 2 IoT based experiment. So one is the IoT based weather monitoring system, okay? So for that we have planned to conduct hands on sessions, okay, using this particular simulator, either Tinkercad or Proteus, okay? And next experiment is MQTT based experiment. So this experiment requires Python and MyMQTT app. So coming into the continuous assessment, okay, that is your mark continuous assessment scheme. So the record marks will be for 40, okay, and assessment test for 30 marks, and assessment test 2 for 30, okay. So here we have introduced project based learning in the continuous assessment 2, okay. So your CAT 2 evaluation will be based on your project presentation, okay? So average of all the experiment weightage for average of all the experiments 40 marks, and the CAT 1 will be evaluated for 30, and CAT 2 will be evaluated for 30. So that is completely based on your project presentation, okay? And the details of assessment for 40 marks for each experiment, program 15 marks, algorithm 10 marks, result 5 marks, okay, Viva Voice 10 marks. For CAT 1 split up, program 15, algorithm 5, result 5, Viva Voice 5, and total 30 marks. So this table shows the assessment for 30 marks for the project evaluation, okay? So we have identified few projects based on second cycle experiment, okay? So we have 2 lists, okay? One is the based on ARM embed simulator based project, and other one is the Tinkercad or Proteus based project. So we are going to design prototype based project, okay? So you can select one project on your own interest from this list, okay? Either it can be ARM embed based project or IoT based project, okay? So you will be given with the complete problem statement, hardware requirements and tools, okay? So the CAT 2 will be evaluated based on this splitter, that is originality and innovation 5 marks, contribution and demo 10 marks, presentation, Viva Voice and report preparation 15 marks, totally is assigned with 30. Is that clear, students?
Yes,
ma'am. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, are you clear with your internal assessment?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Actually, the purpose of this project component is to improve your programming skill, okay? So my advice would be, don't try to copy the code from internet or book, okay? It will spoil your programming skill. So be honest and make the best out of it, okay? You can choose simple project and try to incorporate all the features with the online software tools, that is using online software tools. Diana?
Ma'am?
So Diana, madam, will give you the general instruction, lab instruction.
See, good morning, students.
Good morning.
Yes. So, like the microcontrollers lab, embedded systems lab, also we have two batches as group A, batch 1, and group B as batch 2. And we'll be allocating different staffs to some particular groups. Okay, so this is the batch split up, and roll number, register number 128, you'll be under Dr. M. Pungode ma'am. Okay, so all the record corrections, everything, the output verification will be done by Dr. M. Pungode ma'am. And from register number 9 to 16, you're allotted to Ms. Logan Aigi ma'am. You can make a note of it, and I'll also post this split up in the classroom also. And from 17 to 24, I'll be handling, and from 25 to 33, Dhanlakshmi ma'am will take care of those students. Okay, so the record correction, any doubts in the experiment, output verification, and for CAT, everything you'll be under this faculty. Okay, and this time also we have the online lab. Ma'am has decided to split as small groups so that you can directly interact with the faculty members and get your doubts cleared. Okay, so suppose if the lab is from 11 to 12:45, the first half an hour will be for evaluation of the previous experiment. Okay, suppose this week if you are completing experiment number 1, so next week from 11 to 11:30, all the batch students will enter to the individual Gmeet links. Suppose for Pungode ma'am, from register number 1 to 8, at 11 o'clock should use this Gmeet link, okay, and show your outputs that you have done in the last experiment, and if you have any doubts you can get clarified. Okay, so Viva will be asked for the previous experiment individually. So for the first 10 minutes, roll register number 1, 2, 3 will be joining the meet and will have an interaction with ma'am. Okay, you should share the screen. You should explain her how you have got the output. You should explain the code, and whatever she's asking, you'll be able to answer. Viva will be asked and you'll be evaluated in the 10 minutes time. Okay, after 10 minutes, register number 4, 5, 6 will join the meet. Okay, and after 10 minutes, 7 and 8 will join the meet. You should share your screen, show the output, explain the code, whatever it is asked, you should do. Okay, so the thing is, you should complete the experiment in 1 week's time. You should join the link at the correct time using the correct current link. Okay, similarly for all the faculty. So in the same 30 minutes, each one of you, each faculty will be in different links. So they'll be handling their students for evaluating the previous experiment. And at 11:30 exactly, you should join the common link. Okay, what we are using now. And experiment and the current week's experiment will be explained to you. So you'll take 1 week's time, you'll complete that current week experiment, and the next Monday from 11 to 11:30, we'll have an interactive session and we'll be awarding record marks based on the explanation and the Viva that you answer. Okay, is this clear? So this is for the other batch students also who will be coming on Friday. So Friday we have from 2 to 3:45. So the first half an hour will be for record evaluation. Okay, no separate Viva or no separate Google Forms will be circulated for answering the Viva questions. Okay, so kindly prepare and come. Thoroughly prepare and come the previous experiment. Theory also you should know, because we may ask theory question as it involves Viva voice. Okay, am I clear? So I'll post this split up in the Google Classroom so that you can note the link and join the link at the appropriate time. Okay, for the first time slot. So we have three batches in each group. Okay, so for the first time slot, first batch should join. And for the second 10 minutes, second batch should join. And for the third 10 minutes, the third batch should join. Okay, each batch will have a maximum of 3 students so that you can easily interact with the faculty and get your doubts cleared. Yes, am I clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So this is the new thing we are doing in this lab. So kindly make use of this opportunity, because this embedded systems and IoT, you'll be using it in the future, okay, for placement purpose. These topics will be very much asked. Okay, so please pay attention and encoding your codes, and also get your doubts clarified then and there. Ma'am?
Yes, then, ma'am.
Avlo thana, ma'am?
Avlo.
Okay, ma'am.
So kindly refer the or go through the material, because whatever material we are posting in the Google Classroom, don't ignore the study material, okay? Because it is very difficult to follow the ARM Cortex data code flow. So whatever doubts you have, then and there you get it clarified, and you can get the help from the faculty members and interact the faculty members, okay? Since it is a programming lab, and also we are going to study advanced processor. It's not like a 8-bit, your 8085 or 8086, okay? So we are going to study 32-bit processor, okay? So it is very difficult to understand the data flow model, okay? So whatever doubts you have, then and there, you get it clarified, okay? Is that clear, students?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Okay, shall we start the first experiment? Yes.
Ma'am, they didn't say about the teacher allotment for batch 2, ma'am, group B, ma'am.
What is that?
Ma'am, for group B, they didn't say about the teacher allotment.
They will circulate, Sheshastri. Mm-hmm.
Okay, ma'am.
Diana, madam, will upload the details in the Google Classroom, okay? So the first experiment is a very basic experiment for the study of ARM Cortex M4 architecture and simple program. So in this experiment, we are going to see about 32-bit, simple 32-bit addition, subtraction, multiplication, and division. Okay. So you must think of 32-bit numbers, okay? Instead of 8-bit, 16-bit numbers, you have to use, that is, you have to use in your programs 32-bit numbers, since the processor involved is 32-bit processor. Once again,
Dhanalakshmi, ma'am.
Diana?
Ma'am, your mic is on.
Okay.
ओके ठीक है हम वेट
करेंगे
ओके 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 सर
थैंक यू
मैम पुंगोदे मैम
हाँ एस एस डायना
यस मैम यस
So the study material is included with ARM Cortex M3 or M4 processor architecture. Okay, complete architecture detail, and also the features of STM32 processor details. Okay, so here you have STM32 F44X devices. So it is one of the development board. So this board is called Nucleo board. Okay. So all the features are given in the study material. Just go through it. So this is the data flow model of your ARM, general conventional ARM processor. So I have covered this one in the previous theory class. Okay. And the register details. So how many registers we have? How many registers we have?
R0 to R15.
The register file. How many number of registers in the register file? ARM Cortex register file. Totally 16 files. Okay, and 12 of them are utilized for general purpose, and 3 will be used for special purpose. Okay, so R13 is the stack pointer, and R14 is the link register, and R15 is the program counter, and these. Three registers are special registers, that is program status register, exception mask register, and control register. So I will explain these three registers later. Okay. And also, this material is included with complete ARM Cortex M4 instruction set. Okay. So kindly go through all the information given in this material. Okay. So. It has been included with all your data processing instruction, load and store instruction, automatic instruction, logical instruction, compare instruction, branch and stack operation, and DSP related operation, that is floating point operation. Everything is available in this material. Just go through it. Okay. So these are the sample programs we are going to do in this lab class. That is simple 32-bit addition. 32-bit subtraction, multiplication, and division. Okay. So before we start the experiment number one, it is important to understand introduction to embedded software development and software compilation flow and KIMS core structure. So these three are very important. Okay. So we will see one by one. So this is the embedded software development process. Okay, so this development flow depends on the compiler suite we use. Okay, so we are going to use this Scale Microvision IDE. Okay, so this flow is based on Scale IDE. Okay, so assuming that we are using this Scale IDE version. Okay. So the first step, we need to create a project. Okay, so you need to create a project that will specify the location of source file, compile target, memory configuration, and compilation options. Okay, so you might have done this in your 8051 Kale IDE. So the first step is the create a project. Okay, based on your processor selection. Okay, after that. You need to add the supporting files. Okay, so what files are to be added? Already you have done Kale IDE experiments in 8051 environment. So what files are to be added? So what files are required to compile your assembly program and embedded C program?
From source file.
Yeah, source file. Very good. Next. So you need to add the source code files required by the project, and also you might need to specify the path of any included header file in the project options. Okay, so that is the second step. Okay, so you need to add the source files, code files required by the project. It may be a driver library, application code, or middleware software layers. Okay, so third step is the setup project option. So what steps are involved in this setup project option?
And build.
So what is the first one? So first memory map. And fourth is the debugging. So we need to set up four project options. First, you need to select the processor or controller based on the application, and you need to set the frequency, and you have to define the memory mapping, so which memory location you are going to use. And fourth one, the debugging, whether you are going to opt simulator option or debug option. Okay, just you look at this window. So this is the tail IDE, that is MTK ARM version. Okay, so this is your project window. Here we have to include all our files, and this window is the project option window. So here you need to select your processor. So processor is STM32F446 RTX processor, and also you have to specify the frequency. So here the frequency is 12 megahertz. So you can use the frequency from 12 megahertz to 16 megahertz. Please note it down. Either you can make it as 12 or 16. Okay. Suppose if you want hex file generation. Okay, so here you have to click this hex file, create hex file, and this is for your listing and also memory mapping. Okay, and this window is the linker window, and this window is the very important thing, that is debug window. Okay, so we are here we have two options. Okay, so in Kale MTK version, there are two options. One is the simulator mode, okay, and another one is the debug mode. So this mode is called debug mode. Okay, in simulator mode, generally it doesn't require any hardware platform. Okay, so you can develop either assembly language program or C program and check your results using registers, memory window, and watch window. Okay, so there is no need of hardware. Okay, you without hardware we can simulate both assembly language program and embedded C program. Okay, but in case of debugging mode, okay, it requires hardware. So we need to connect your board. It can be a development board or student version board to your PC. So in this mode, we can download the code into the hardware and verify the results in real time. Okay, so we have settings here. We need to enable these two options to download the code from Kale IDE version to your targeted hardware. For that, you need to connect the hardware into your PC. Is that clear, students? So two different simulation environment. One is the simulator mode. For that, it doesn't require any hardware platform. Generally, we can write the code in the text editor using debug option, we can compile it and check the results. Okay, but in case of debug option, the only condition is your development board should have onboard debugger. Okay, so using this debug option, we can download the code into the flash memory of your development. Is that clear, students? Is that clear? So
yes.
You need to connect the board to PC through USB cable. Okay, the condition is that your board should have debug adapter. So after setting up your project option, once the code is ready, we have to compile the code and link the code. Okay, so what is the difference between these two terms? Please tell me, compile and link.
Compile is to check if any errors and warnings are there.
What is the output format? What will be the output format after compilation? It is in the form of object file, or it is in the form of hex file?
Object file.
Okay. So your project contains a number of files that are compiled separately using compiler. Okay. After compilation process, each source file will have a corresponding object file. Okay. In order to generate a final compiled executable image, a separate linking process is required. So that will be take care of your linker. Okay. So what is the role of linker?
It is
used to combine all the separate object file, and finally it will generate executable hex file. So this file is called ROM image. So this file should be downloaded into your hardware. For that, the linker is required. So we have to do compile as well as link. Okay. So once the process is completed, okay, once the process is completed, we need to flash the code into the development board. So for some development board, okay, supports onboard debugging feature, and some boards don't support onboard debugging features. Okay, suppose if the onboard debugging feature is not available, suppose if a board does not have onboard debugger, for that you have to use this new link adapter. So this is a separate adapter which is designed by Kale Software IDE. Okay, is that clear, students? So this device is called JTAG device. That is, using JTAG we can download the code into the targeted software, targeted hardware. Is that clear? Development board, suppose if the development board does not support onboard debug adapter, so that case you have to use this new link. Okay, suppose if the board has onboard debug adapter, that case we can directly connect the board using USB. So for downloading the code into the flash memory, either you can have new link adapter or onboard debug adapter. Is that clear, students? So these are the steps involved in your embedded software development, especially your ARM IDE. So you have to create project and add your files to the project and set up project options based on your development board, and you need to perform both compile and link. So after the linking process, the IDE will generate executable single hex file. So that file is downloaded into the hardware either using new link adapter or JBug adapter. Okay. So do you have any doubts in this block diagram? So this is the software compilation flow. C compiler, so we have four main components: C compiler, assembler, linker, and flash flow. So let's assume we are developing our project using C programming language, okay? So your project might also contain some assembly files. It requires some assembly files. So those files are supplied by your microcontroller vendor. So it can be your startup file. So even though we are developing C programming, the project requires assembly file that will be provided by your microcontroller vendor. Okay. So what is the role of C compiler? So what is the job of C compiler? Compile C programming files into object files. Okay. Similarly, assembler assemble used to assemble assembly code files into object files. Okay. So what is the role of linker? It is a software tool to join multiple object files together and define memory configuration. Okay. Finally, it will generate executable. Okay. So we can test the code either in the simulator environment or debugger environment. Okay. For simulator environment, it doesn't require hardware. Okay. And debugging environment, we need to connect external hardware. So we have to check the program using real hardware. So once the program is ready, okay, once the ROM image is ready, it can be downloaded into the flash memory through USB cable. Okay. So this is the software compilation. Yes.
Will this linker will provide only hex output, ma'am? Hex file, ma'am.
Files, object files together and define memory configuration.
Ma'am?
Yes, Naina.
Your voice is breaking, ma'am.
Popping the network, yeah. One second.
Ang question ketadilende, it's breaking.
Enna question, ma'am? Say Shastri, solunga. Can you repeat that question?
That linker, ma'am, linker will produce only H file or any other type of files, ma'am.
Actually, depends on the processor. Okay. Suppose if you are using Intel processor, it will generate S file. So that is the one of the format that will be accepted from by your flash memory. Okay. So in case of STM processor, the interval linker software tool, that is according to your TALE MicroVision software environment, it will generate hex file. Okay, so that file is called ROM image. ROM image is nothing but a table. It's a separate table. It contains memory address and instruction codes. That's all. So based on the instruction code, your processor interpret the instructions. Based on the instruction, it will perform the operation. Okay. Mainly the linker role is it will fill up all the memories in terms of instruction code is nothing but your output. Okay. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
So similar to compiler, it is like a software tool which is available in your KL MicroBatch. Okay. So here you can have separate component for link. So here we need to define our memory configuration. Based on the memory configuration, it will generate a final downloadable file. So it will be in hex format. Is that clear? So using this window, we can edit our, that is allocate, reserve our memory. Okay. So next one is the KIMS API code structure. So this actually, this is like a vendor independent abstraction layer for the microcontroller are based on ARM Cortex processor. Okay, so in KL we have separate KIMS option. So look at this window. So this is the one of the software component. What is KIMS? KIMS is the Cortex microcontroller software interface standard. It is like an abstraction layer, that is application core. Here we can integrate core processor, digital signal processor, and real-time RTOS, and also drivers, compiler. We can select, so many options are here. You can select the device, okay. You can select the file system. You can select the graphics, and also it supports network. And also it provides all the board supporting features. So using this, we can access the buttons which are available in your boards. And also using this drivers, we can access external peripherals. For LED exclusively, we have API. Using this API, we can access onboard LEDs. Okay. So this software package is exclusively designed for ARM Cortex based processor. Okay. So here we have the KIMS option. So we have mainly three layers. One is the core peripheral access layer and device peripheral access layer. And third one is the middleware access layer. So this middleware access layer does not exist, okay. So this is not available. So we can access these two. So this is your MCU. So it contains your processor core along with special peripherals that is integrated with the peripherals like system timer, and that is vector interrupt controller, debugger, and other peripherals. Okay, so this is your core, ARM core. So ARM core surrounded by specific integrated peripherals. Okay. So the role of this core peripheral access layer, so this layer includes name or definitions, that is your register definitions, okay, address definitions, helper functions to access core registers and core peripherals. So that is the role of this core peripheral access layer, okay. So this is a processor specific, and it is provided by ARM. So this is provided by ARM. And next one is the device peripheral access layer. So this includes name definitions, address definitions of peripheral registers, okay, as well as system implementation, including your interrupt or exceptions, that is vector definitions, okay. So this is device specific, okay. This will be device specific. So this is processor specific. This will be device specific, okay. Is that clear? And device peripheral function, we have driver codes. Using that code, we can develop our application and we can configure the peripherals which are integrated with our ARM environment. So this API is very important to access the feature of ARM MCU, ARM microcontroller unit. So these files are, that is KIMS files are integrated into device driver library packages from microcontroller vendors. Can you understand what is KIMS? KIMS is like a software interface. It's an abstraction layer between your processor and application code. That's all. So it's completely based on ARM Cortex processor. Is that clear, students?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So we are going to use this board, STM32 Nucleo 64 development board with STM32F446RE microcontroller unit. So this unit is completely developed by STM microelectronics. Okay. So these are the features. Okay. So it's a very low cost board, it's a student version board when compared to other ARM boards. So it would cost around 1500 rupees. So if really interested to explore the ARM features, you can purchase this board from the Amazon. Available in many websites. So the specific feature for this is ARM Embed Enable. So using online simulator, we can access this board. So this is your ARM code. And this unit is the debugger unit. So it has an onboard debugger. We can directly connect the board to the PC using this USB adapter. Please refer this link, STM microcontroller. So this board is based on STM32F4X family microcontroller, that is high performance foundation line, and it has ARM Cortex Gen4 core along with DSP unit and floating point unit. And the flash memory size 512 KB, the frequency is 180 MHz. So before selecting any development board, so we need to consider three criteria or factors. So first is about documentation and code support. Okay? And second is about debugger and programming. Okay? So that is very essential in order to develop embedded application codes. Okay? So the important feature of ST Microelectronics is that it maintains all the documents and support. Here you can see it will provide you all the user manuals. Here you can download the data sheets and also the software required by the hardware board. Okay, everything is available in the website. Okay. So the website, you can find all the details, all the documentation, and application notes here, okay, reference manuals, sample codes, and everything you can able to get it, okay. So another important feature is that this board has onboard ST link debugger and programmer, okay. So here at the top of the board is the debugger. So this part is the debugger. This complete part is ST link debugger and programmer. So this is really important for embedded programming, because debugging is essential and you should always have a onboard debugger. Okay, so the features of this board is they support almost all the peripherals, okay. So using this Arduino compatible Morpho connectivity, we can connect all the peripherals, okay. So you can interface the Arduino shields onto this hardware. And this board does not come with any sensor, okay. And also you don't find much LEDs, only one LED is present, okay. So that is the onboard LED here. So this is the onboard LED component, and it has one user button as well as one reset button. So the blue one is the user button and this black one is the reset button. And it has the virtual COM port and debug port. So that means you can connect your board to the PC. So it will enumerate as virtual. Will enumerate as virtual port in your PC. So using this USB adapter, you can connect this board to your laptop. So these are the features of your Nucleo board. So I am going to connect the board to my laptop. Okay, so here you can see the board is detected. Okay, and go to device manager. So look at here. So this board is connected to COM5 port. So we can communicate to the board over UART protocol by just connecting my board to the PC without using any external USB to UART converter dongle. So we can directly connect the board to my laptop. Okay. So it has been identified as a virtual device. Okay. So these are the features of this STM Nucleo 64 development. So instruction in the ARM Cortex-M4 processor can be divided into various groups based on the functionality. So data transfer instruction, that is moving data within processor, separate memory access instruction, since your ARM Cortex-M4 supports load and store architecture, so we have separate load and store instruction, and we have automatic instruction and special multiply accumulate instruction to enhance the flexibility of multiplication operation. And we have 32-bit division instruction, logical operation, shift and rotate operations. Okay, so these operations are handled by your parent shifter in order to improve the Cortex-M4 performance. This hardware component is included in the architecture to improve the performance of 32-bit multiplication and division. Okay, and also we have conversion operation, bit field processing instruction, branch instruction and interrelated instructions. Okay, so this class we are going to see about data transfer instruction and arithmetic. So coming into data processing instructions, okay. So data processing instruction manipulate data within register, not on memory. So for all the data processing instruction, we must use R0 to R15 registers alone. Okay. So our microcontroller can perform data processing operations on internal registers only, not on memory. Okay. So that is a very important point to access your ARM Cortex instructions, assembly instruction. Only work on registers, not on memory. Okay. So here, four types of instructions under this data processing category. One is the data movement instruction. Second one is the comparison. Third one is the logical, and fourth one is the arithmetic instructions. So there are move instruction, arithmetic instruction, logical instruction, compare instruction, and also we have multiply. So this multiply, division come under arithmetic operation. Okay. So this is the syntax we have to follow. Okay. That is operation of the instruction. So here you can use move instruction, add instruction, subtract instruction, any instruction you can use it here. And every instruction can be included with this conditional attribute. Okay, I will explain this later. Okay, and this S is for flag updation. Okay, so we have two categories of instruction. That is instruction without S suffix, instructions with S suffix. Okay. So instructions can be used with or without S suffix. Suppose if we include S suffix in the instruction, means after the operation, the flags will be updated in the program status register. Please note it down. This program status register is very similar to your 8051 PSW. Once the arithmetic and logical operation is completed, based on the ALU results, the flag will be affected if we include S suffix in the instruction. Are you able to follow, students?
Ma'am, can you please repeat it, ma'am?
Actually, instructions can be used with or without S suffix. Okay, so this is the optional one. Suppose if we include this F suffix, means based on the ALU results, the flag will be updated in PSR register. PSR register is program status register. It is very similar to your PSW in 8051. In 8051, so what is the role of PSW? It will have carry flag status, zero flag status, auxiliary carry flag status, parity, and negative. That is sign flag. Okay. So if F suffix is included in the instruction, it will update the flag status in PSR register. Okay, so I will explain in more detail in the coming slide. Okay, is it clear, students?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am. If it is not included, it will be in PSW, ma'am.
Yeah, the flags will not be updated in the PSW.
Okay.
So based on this F suffix, your flags will be affected. Is that clear? So we have two operands, source operands, RN and operand 2. This operand 2 is handled by your parallel shifter. and after the addition or subtraction, and result will be transferred to your destination register. Okay, so this is the syntax you have to follow. So you have to specify the instruction. Okay, first you have to specify the instruction. Next, if you have any conditional attribute, incorporate that conditional attribute. If you want to update the flag status, include this S, otherwise ignore the S. And you need to specify three operands. Two operands are source operand, and this will be your destination operand. Okay. So first we will see about this data movement instruction. Normal move instruction, move not, move top, move what. Okay. After that, I will explain arithmetic logic and comparison. Okay. So this is the XPSR register. So PSR is nothing but program status register. Just you concentrate these bits alone. Ignore remaining. I will explain that later. Okay. Your 31st bit holds negative flag status and 30th bit holds zero flag status. 29th bit holds carry flag and 28th bit holds overflow and 27th bit holds saturation. And don't bother about this. So this is mainly for floating point operation. So you need to concentrate these four flags alone. That is negative flag, zero flag, carry or borrow or hold. So we don't have separate borrow. While doing addition operation, carry will be updated. While doing subtraction operation, the borrow will be updated in 29th. Is that clear, students? So based on the ALU results, these flag will be updated in XPSR register. Okay. So if the result is negative, okay, if the result is negative, negative flag will be set. If the result is zero, zero flag will be set. So if there is a assigned overflow, overflow flag will be set to one. If any additional carry is generated, the carry flag will be 1. So the bit sizes from 0 to 31st. Okay. If any additional carry generated from 31st bit, the carry flag will be set. And this overflow flow is for signed numbers. That is, if the result exceeds the limit, the overflow flag will be set to 1. Is that clear, students? Students, do you have any doubts regarding this? The other students can interact. Only few, we are getting a reply from few students only. What about others? Any doubts?
Clear, no.
Okay. So how do you identify the result is a positive result and negative result? How do you identify the result as a positive number and negative number?
Negative flag.
Based on the negative flag. So in case of your 8051, how do you identify the number as a positive number and negative number?
Carry flag.
So which bit represents your signed magnitude? Which bit holds signed magnitude?
The MSB.
MSB, ma'am.
Eighth bit. When eighth bit is 1, the 0 to, let's assume 0 to 7. We have totally 8 bits. So this 7th bit is 1 means that number is going to be a negative number. If it is 0, it is going to be positive. Okay. So in this ARM Cortex case, we need to check the 31st bit. Okay. If the 31st bit is 1 means the result is negative. If the 31st bit is 0, the result is positive. Is that clear, students? So in this way, we can identify the number as a positive number or negative number. Okay. So let's take this example. So this number is a 32-bit number. Okay. So just you write it in binary and check the 31st bit. And tell me this number is a positive number or negative?
Negative.
This is your last bit. So 1, 1, 1. Okay. Suppose if the number is 0FFF. So this number is a positive number or negative number?
Positive.
So 0, 0, 0. So this will be your 31st bit. Okay. So this is going to be a positive number and this is going to be negative number. So we have 4 flags, negative flag, zero flag, carry flag and overflow flag. So based on the ALU results, the flag will be updated in your XPSR register. So this XPSR is the program status register. Okay. So these are some of the directives that we are going to use in our lab experiments. Okay. So directives are not instructions. Okay. So the role of this, that is the objective of the assembly directive, is to reserve memory space and define types. Define the instruction types. Okay. So they are used to provide key information for the assembly programming. So the circled assembler directives are frequently used in our programs. So first one is the area. Okay. So area is a directive which instructs the assembler to assemble new code section or data section. So using this assembler directive, we can create a new block of data section, a new block of code section. Okay, and next is the entry. So declare an entry point where the program execution starts. And we have 4 data definition assembler directives: DCB, DCW, DCD, and equal. Okay, so DCB is define constant byte. Please note it down. Define constant byte. So it is used to allocate one or more bytes of data. Next one is define constant word. So which is used to allocate one or more half words, that is 16 bits of data. DCD allocate one or more words of data, that is 32 bit size. So equal is used to give. Yes.
Excuse me. Can you repeat what is DCW?
DCB is define constant byte. Okay. This is define constant word. This is define constant data. This is equal. So using this equal, you can assign a variable name to a numeric constant. We can assign a variable to a numeric constant. It can be a 8-bit number or 16-bit number or 32-bit number. Next one is the export. It is used to declare a symbol and make it referable by other source file. So actually this is used to make your code visible to the linker. So something related to linking operation. Okay. So end represents end of source file. So these are some of the assembler directives which are used in assembly level programs. So area is for defining your area code, code section, and data section. So entry will represent the starting of program execution, and four constants. It's defined constant that can be used in your data section: DCB, DCW, DCB, and equal. And export is something related to your linker. Okay, and make your code visible to linker. Okay, and end is for termination. So this is the structure of your assembly. So this is the first one, first instruction for defining your code section. Okay. So for that you need to use this assembler directive. Area is one of the assembler directive which instructs the assembler to assemble new code section or data section. Suppose if you want to assemble data section instead of code, you have to use data. Okay, so area is the assembler directive. This is your code name. It's a user defined one. You can give any name. Okay, so I am using main. Okay, and code is the assembler directive. So it actually this represent your machine instructions. Okay, which means it representing the particular code contains machine instructions. And default mode for this section is read only. So to write your program code, you have to specify your code area using this syntax: area, code name, and code comma read only. So exporters make this main visible to linker, and this is the entry point, and this is the start. Here you have to start your code. You can include your code, and it should be terminated with end assembler directive. Do you have any doubts up to this?
Clear
to you? No doubts, no doubts.
So first we will see about move instructions. So we can use these instruction with S suffix or without S suffix. Okay. So what is the purpose of this S suffix?
It implements
update the flag status in APSR register. That is PSR register. Okay. So move is a simple ARM instruction. It copies the value from source register to destination register. Okay. So let's look at this first instruction: move R4 comma R9. So, what is the function of this instruction? It is similar to your 8051. What is the function of this?
I copy the value.
The value of R0 will be taken from
R0. The value of R0
will be copied to R4.
Stored in
R4. This R0 may be 8-bit number, 16-bit number, or 32-bit number. Okay. So size of R0 is 32-bit. So R0 and R4 are 32-bit register. So we can move That is, copy the 32 bit value from source register to destination register. So after execution, your R4 holds the R0 content and R0 returns the same value. Is that clear, students? And next one is the move S, that is move with the flag of update. Okay. So based on the conditional attribute, your flag will be affected. Okay. So this S is used to update the flag status in APSR register after execution of this particular instruction. Is that clear? And next one is the move R3 comma hash 0x34. So the 30, after execution, this 34 is loaded into R3. It's copied into R3. So the move instruction can support immediate operands also. Okay? And again, move with flag update. So after the data transferred into R3, the flag will be updated in APSR register. And these two are something different. There is move work. Okay. So this instruction is used to move 16-bit hex value to the lower half word of R6. Is that clear, students? I'm trying to move 16-bit hex value, okay, to the lower half word of R6. After execution, your R6 holds this 1234. Is that clear? Your lower bits are filled with 1, 2, 3, 4. Remaining bits will be clear. Is that clear? So after execution, your R6 holds 0, 0, 0, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. 32 bit value. Okay. And next one is the move top. Okay. So this instruction used to move 16-bit value, hex value, to the upper half word of R6. Okay. So in earlier, your R6 holds this number. Okay. After execution of this move top instruction, your R6 holds 8, 7, 6, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4. So your upper 16-bit, that is upper half word, is filled with 16-bit data. So move word is for loading your lower half word, and move top is for loading upper half word. Is that clear?
Yes, ma'am.
And next one is the move not. Move not R3 comma R7 means after execution, your R3 holds the ones complement of R7. So it will perform ones complement operation. So the negative value of R7 is transferred into R3, that is copied into R3. Is that clear, students?
Yes, ma'am.
I will demonstrate these instructions in Kale Microvision. Diana?
Ma'am,
execution procedure for you, Diana.
Yes, ma'am.
Lab time in actually 11 to
45, ma'am.
12:45.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. So now we'll see the Kale Microvision procedure execution steps. This is already in your experiment one material, and if possible, you can have that with you. So I'm opening the Kale Microvision file. So you should get like this, ARM Kale Microvision 5. Hope everyone would have loaded this software in your laptop. Is it? Everyone, okay, everyone should have this software in your laptop, okay, or else it will be very difficult for you to run the codes.
Have you all installed?
Yes, ma'am.
Is there anybody who haven't installed or any have any trouble installing? Do any have any difficulty in installing the software?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So for all the experiments, you need this Microvision 5. Okay, Kale Microvision 5. For all the 10 experiments, you need this. So it is mandatory that you should have this in your laptop. The very first step is you should go to project. So this is the home screen you'll be getting. After getting the screen, you should click on the project and new Microvision project. Okay, it will ask for saving the project. You should create a folder in a specific folder drive. I'm using an E drive under that experiment number one. I'm creating a folder as demo. Okay, so I'm creating the project with file name experiment 1 demo with extension .uv project. Okay, .uvprog or .uvprojx. Okay, I'm saving this. So now after saving the project, it will ask for the device, target device to be selected. Okay. So we are using, as ma'am said, we'll be using the STM board. Once again, connect the board. So you should select, am I audible?
Yes,
ma'am. STM32F446, and under that you should choose STM32F446RE. Under that you should select STM32F446RETX. Okay, so the step-by-step procedure, it's given in the manual. You can see the manual or else you can note it down. Okay, under STM Microelectronics, STM32F4 series, STM32F446, STM32F446RE, under that RETX. Okay, and click OK. Then next is managing runtime environment. Under that, in KIMS, you should check the score. Okay, and under device, you should click the startup. Okay, and under the board support, you should click Nucleo F446RE. Clear? Under the manage runtime environment, you should select the board and select the core under KIMS and select the startup under device. Clear? Three things you should do. Right? A target has been created with KIMS and a device. So now create a new text document and you should code in this area. So let me copy the code what we have in for experiment number one. See, this is the material in which the code is given. So in the Kale Microvision, this indent is very much important. Okay, so if you run the code as such without following the indent, you'll end up in errors, right? So after the coding is done, you have a symbol like a magic stick, options for target. Okay, click on this and you should ensure the same device has been selected. Under target, you should select default compiler version 5. Okay, you should select the ARM compiler version as 5. Somebody talking? Do any have any doubt? Okay, fine. So you should select the compiler version as 5. So, and you should check the crystal oscillator frequency as 12. Okay, so sometimes it may be set with some other frequency. Ensure that it is set with 12. Right? ARM compiler should be set with compiler version 5. And nothing to do with all these. And under debug, you should select ST link debugger. Okay, there will be several debugging options from which you should select ST link debugger, which is exclusively for STM boards. Okay, under target, you should select the compiler version 5. Under device, you should select ST link debugger. Okay, these two things you have to do under options for target. Clear? So once this is done, now you should save your text in the same folder which you have created. So under under E drive, under ES lab, under experiment number one, under demo, I have saved this Microvision project, right? In the same folder, I'll be now saving this text with extension with extension dot s. Okay, so now it's been saved. Okay, now you can see the change in colors. So the next step is we have a project and we have this notepad or text somewhere else. So we should link text with the project. Okay. So for that, you should right click source group one. Yeah. So we have created a project and we have created a new document and we have code it, right? So you have to link this document to your project. For that, you have to right click source group 1. And you have to click add existing files to group source group 1. Okay, so I have this document already and I have to link that source group to the project which I have created. Okay, so now you can see this addition program, this document.s. You have to click it and you have to add it. Suppose this program is not visible within the scope, and you can expand the file type, and you should choose the appropriate file type and take this document. Okay, so you can simply select this addition program.s, and if you press add, it will get it will be under group 1. Okay, so now this addition program has been brought to the source group 1 of my project experiment 1 demo. Clear? Clear?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
So what's the first step we did? We have created new project. We have created new folder and we have saved a project, and it had asked for the target device. We have given that as STM, that series, and then it had asked for managing the runtime environment. Under that, we included device, kims, and one more thing, board support. And after that, you can do the coding, and under options, you should change the compiler version and the debugging option, okay? And after that, you should include the file or the code area to the project by right clicking the source group 1, and you should add the existing files to the source group 1. And once it is done, a document or the file or the code will be taken under the project. Okay, now it's time for compiling. First you should translate. If there are any errors, it will be shown here, and after that build. So under build also there are no errors, and after that rebuild. Okay, we have no errors. Now I have connected the Nucleo STM board, and I'll now be watching the output. So after saving this, you should translate, build, rebuild. And if you don't get any errors, then you can go for debugging. Suppose I'll show you the indent error. Let's see whether, there is no code, there is no error actually, but there is some problem with the alignment in the first three lines. Okay, it is showing three errors. So you should be very, very careful in the indent also. Okay, so save this. And if you run it now, you will not have any errors. So in the initial stages, you will be getting too many errors, and as you get practiced, you will not get any errors. Okay. So now let's debug. So what's the answer you'll be getting? See, addition 7F and 3. One of the input is 7F and 3, and the other input is 7F and E. So what's the output you'll be getting? 7F and 1. Okay, let's see whether we are getting it. Okay. See here, R0 is FF, 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 F3, and R1 is FF, 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 FE. Okay, so these two values, first this value is taken to R0, next the second value will be taken to R1, and the addition of these two is stored in R2. Here you can find the result. Clear?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
So you can use this add instruction with or without s suffix. Okay. Suppose if you include s suffix in the add instruction, your flags will be updated. Okay. Diana, முடிச்சிட்டியா நான் flag காமிக்கிட்டா உங்களுக்கு?
Yes, ma'am. Subtraction, division.
இல்ல சொல்லலாம் இது மூவ்ஸ் முடிச்சேன்.
Okay, 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 ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Can you see my screen?
Yes, ma'am.
See, this is a simple 32-bit addition code. So as Diana madam said, the 32-bit operand is copied into R0. So this is the first line, and this is the structure you have to follow. First, you have to define the code memory and export the main program, and you have to give entry and end. Okay, entry is for starting of program, end is for terminating the program. Okay, so the 32-bit constant is loaded into R0 after execution of this particular instruction. Okay, and again I am loading the same 32-bit value into R1. Okay, and now I am adding R0 with R1. Okay, and after that I am storing the result in R2. Okay, so this instruction can be used with s suffix or without s suffix. Okay, so first we will do this add without s suffix. Okay, so add these two hexadecimal number and find out the answer. So this is the answer. After adding, we should get 1. Okay, with how many x? 4x and 3f followed by e. Okay. So first, I will add these two without s suffix. Okay. See, you can do this program in the simulator mode. Okay. So we have two options, simulator mode and debug option. If you don't have any hardware, okay, you can use this simulator environment. For that, you have to select this use simulator. So I am running this code in the simulator mode, okay. So there are zero errors and zero warning. Okay. So code is successfully executed. That is successfully compiled without any errors. And go to debugging environment. Okay. So here you can see there are 16 registers under register window. From R0 to R15, and these three registers are special function register, and remaining register can be used for general purpose. Okay, from R0 to R12, and this R0 to R6 are called low register. For 16-bit operation, you can make use of these registers. For 32-bit operation, you can make use of R7 to R15, and this register is the XPSR register. This will represent your all the flag status: negative flag, zero flag, carry flag, and overflow. Okay, so I will execute the code. So under simulation, just you click the instruction and enable this run to cursor line option. Okay. So I'm going to execute this first instruction. Okay. Look at here. Your program counter is pointing this address. So this address has the first instruction of this program. That is move R0, 32-bit value. Okay. So look at here. Your R0 is loaded with some value. Okay. 32-bit value. And next I am going to execute the second instruction. So here your pointer is pointing this one, because this has been completed and this add instruction is about to execute. Add instruction is about to execute. So after addition, okay, your result, that is result will be holded by R2 register. At the same time, look at the carry flag status. Okay. Previously, the carry is set to 1. Okay. So before execution, just clear and check the status with S suffix and without S suffix. Okay. I'm going to execute first instruction. Okay. So before addition, you clear the carry flag status. Okay. So now add is about to execute. Clear this and clear this negative flag. Okay. So carry is not updated because S suffix is not included in the instruction. Since the carry is, even though set, okay, the carry flag is not updated because we are not using add S instruction, okay. Suppose if the S is included, the carry flag status will be updated in program status register. So the first instruction has been executed. So your R0 is updated with 32-bit value. Okay, look at here. And next R1 is updated this value. And before execution, before add instruction execution, clear these two flag status. Now S suffix is included in the instruction. Okay. Now you can see the carry is updated. So based on the ALU results, your flag will be affected, but to read the flag status, you need to incorporate this S suffix in the instruction. Okay. So do you have any doubts regarding this? So you can try this code with subtraction with S suffix, multiplication with S suffix, div and div S. Any doubts?
No doubts.
And also try this code, that is move instruction. Just you explore the, that is execute the instruction and explore the, observe the results. Okay. So simple move instructions only. Okay. And move instructions can also be used with or without S suffix. Okay. You can try this code with and without S suffix. So the first instruction is the moving 32-bit value into R0. Second is moving 32-bit value into R1. Just I'm copying the value from R1 to R0. Okay. And I'm using this move word instruction. So this instruction is used to place this 16-bit value into the lower word of this R0 register. And this one is 8765 is placed in the upper half word of R0 register. And move not performs once complement operation. So just you try this code and observe the results. So you have to complete this program with and without a suffix and complete add, addition, subtraction, multiplication, division with a suffix and without a suffix. So Friday class, you should come with all the outputs. You have to present.
So Friday they have to present addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, ma'am.
Along with move instructions.
Okay, ma'am. So Friday we have afternoon lab. So ma'am, ana paadi paadi dhaan potrukolla ma'am.
Illa illa, ipo avanga just try pandra. It's very similar.
Okay, okay.
51 dyna.
Okay, okay, ma'am.
So add is for adding 32 bit value and check the results. We will explain the remaining concepts in the next class. Okay. And subtraction, just you infer the result, how it will subtract the 32-bit value. And for multiplication, syntax is MUL. Just you note it down. The syntax is given in the slide. Add ADD, subtract SUV. Multiplication, similar to your 82-1, MUL. You should use three operands. Division, you have to use unsigned div. Don't use B. Okay, you should use BCDID. Then you replace the code with SUB, MUL, and UDID and observe the results. And show us the results in the Friday class.
Should they join in different links which is circulated or?
Yeah, ma'am.
Sharing, ma'am. Sharing, ma'am.
So any doubts, students? Students, do we have any doubts?
No, ma'am.
No, ma'am.
See, next Friday also, we'll be continuing with experiment number 1. Okay.
So we in the Friday class, we are going to focus on signed addition and unsigned. That is signed arithmetic operation and unsigned arithmetic operation. So how to use your add, subtract.
Ma'am? Ma'am?
Ma'am, your voice is not audible.
Yes, you consider unsigned 32-bit value and check the check your results. Okay. Is that clear? Is that clear, students?
Yes, ma'am.
Dina, Bharatha, solnuma?